jetzt die halbe Kamera, that's my old camera, that was my first camera, and I have some images with this camera as well. It's a little bit less megapixels. So there, and you need a, you have this cut some cable, the sun just is in the frame. But it works, work great. So, and let's now come to the white light imaging tools. White light, you must have a good filter, a certified filter. Can be Myra filter or this is a glass filter. That's with the camera filter on the camera as well, especially for partial solar eclipse is important. And that's for imaging of partial eclipses as well. So conditions for good quality images. What needs to be happening that the image is good? It's the equipment must be of good quality, must be well maintained, clear sky at least in 10 seconds, and hopefully not too many high clouds. Rangare is very famous for it. Good seeing, that means not so much haze, not atmospheric interferences, not too wet, and not too hot, not too cold. With the calcium K, it's the best more later, because it needs more exposure, more light. You see the prominence is better, whereas with the hydrogenography, it's more better 1 to 2 hours after sunrise and before sunset to get the base scene conditions. But often you can't have to use what's there. But and with in white light, with good refractors, you can see good color in the factory. So, yes, of course, if the telescope is too long under the sun, that can also have turbulences, can affect the ceiling as well. And the focusing, that's the challenge, to get an exact focus, especially now at the solar minimum, where you have no sunspots. That's especially in calcium K, a little bit of a challenge. But, yeah, that's, it is, yes. I mean, when you see that, you can see all the optimum structures. And then, of course, the double stack is the setting increases the detail, and then we have good processing skills. So that's an example of good seeing, example of bad seeing. Because there's a lot of factors as well, the vibration. The telescope one, when it's on a wooden, and it vibrates as well, that's also not on the battery, for example. That can also have an impact. And yes, I use auto statements. So that's a summary how I capture it before I do the workflow. So that, so I use fire capture, auto sharpen. If sometimes I have to use fix inside this TV flip tool, use Photoshop. The tools, I explain them in the workflow. And yes, and I do a composite between the normal exposed disk and the over exposed component. So that's, I start with fire capture. That's usually I use, not the chart, can you read it? 148 is the 148, the gain is 50, and 148 the gain. And the gamma is 50, so that's what I use. With that setting, it's trial and error, so but that I came to the conclusion the exposure is on the lowest range, up to 0.5 milliseconds. Mm-hmm. And that the lower range is good for the disk and the higher range than for the components. So that's how I stack it with auto stacker. That's usually use the surface tool. It's a little bit broken up the format.
Sorry,
well.
One question. Pardon? One question about the last frame. You capture a video. How long do you capture it for?
Capture about, depends on the scene. Minimum 10, 15 seconds,
oh.
Often more.
Cool.
23 seconds. That's about 120 seconds.
Thank you.
Yeah. So that's the auto stacker. I use normally the surface tool, but sometimes when you have high clouds, I've made the experience sometimes the planet option works as well. So So, and also with the sharpening, you must always look if it's not too pixelated. But recent, I used the more sharpened tool in Photoshop as well. So, as here, surface of planet, and that example was recent, the hydrogen alpha, that was the surface stacked. You see that it's very untidy. It's the clouds, they can get more extreme, but that was untidy. And when I did it with planet, it went nice.
Mm.
So, that's the difference. So when I've done that, the stacking process, and I've chosen the best one, I do more images, then I open it in Photoshop, the sharpened one, and then I crop it, and then I choose the mode because I color it later RGB color instead of the black white mode. Yes, so that's and I save it as TIFF in this JPEG. This JPEG you can email it and yes, it's great. But I save it in house. So then I zoom it to the screen. Before I come back now, that was what I showed also last year, that's the beginning. But now I found out it's not always sharp enough. So I used in Photoshop now the more sharpened tool. Sometimes when it's too noisy, it helps with the speckle to reduce the noise. Sometimes it works. And especially, it's very useful with the bad seeing and with the high clouds. So I've got now much more results, so we'll show later the difference of it. With the prominences I made, the experience is not so good, it's too noisy and too pixelated. So that's a more sharpened example, how I do it. With the filter sharpen and then sharpen more. And then you see the difference. This not sharpened. Is it clear the difference?
Mm-hmm.
And then sometimes I use also this speckle, so this is an example of how to do it. Also with the filter tool, and then reduce the noise. So when it's out to sharpen, when it's all done, now I open the other one, the overexposed images. That's the prominence, copy it again. And now I have all the images there. Now, I open the first image again. Use with a mouse click, the magic wand tool. And unfortunately left here, the bar is not there. That's on the computer here, but I don't know that's full marks. So I use the magic wand tool and click with the mouse when it's a good scene. So then when it's done, you get select inverse and you get that selection. Yeah? And then I edit and copy and paste it then in that overexposed image. Mm. Any questions? That's the main process. And now you see that it's not always the same size. You can change that with the flip transform tool. Yeah, that should be here. So I zoom it in so that I get it right. And I zoom it in so that I get it right. The margin is not too artificial and put it together. That's the flip transform compiled image and black white. Mm-hmm. And then I process it further. So now, before I come to the challenges with the magic wand tool I came out last year, it's not always working, especially when you have bad scene and high clouds. You get this fringing and you get a problem. So then you have alternatives like the click selection or the magnetic lasso. That's a little bit more to work, but it works in any case. That's the ultimate alternative. The magnetic lasso always works. And then as another alternative I found out, the magic eraser, that they do it the other way around. Copy and paste the overexposed image in there. I showed that at the beginning of that part. So that's the fringing here. It's the magic wand. It can be more extreme, I show it. So therefore I was not happy, okay? decided to do it with a magnetic lasso, and that's the result. Yes. Then that's the extreme fringing I did. That was the toughest step one. So I clicked the mouse and I got that. Yeah. That's not working. So what I have to do, use the magnetic lasso and slowly get it around with the mouse. And then that's the result. So that works almost. And so the alternative is also use the overexposed prominences, as I said. They are competing in the normal exposed disk. As I selected, copy it, now it's in the disk, of course. The other disk is gone. It's not asking me where the normal exposed is gone. So I use the magic eraser tool, click the mouse here, and now we see what's happening. You get the disk, but you get also this awkward black circle. It's regular, therefore it's good, it's usable, and then I use the free transform tool again with the overexposed one, but it can happen also like that. Then it's not useful. It's not there. So you have to trial and error what's the best, and maybe I can see. So that's free transform, and that's now the final image. And then I adjust the brightness with that layer one, that's the normal exposed one, and contrast, that's quite an important step to get more out of the image, get more vibrance. And then there's a better contrast. So I took back these both layers. And the good thing is that you get better the prominences, and the prominences are poking out much more. With the cuts and K, it's easy like that. And then I color it. Purple, the original looks a little bit better. It's good. And then color it purple, that's what I usually do, both layers. And then I layer a new, flatten it. Then I have one image now. And often I have to rotate it according to the SDO images. I have to everything there with some applications you can get there. And then you can compare how it is and then adjust it. Mostly I have to rotate 90 degrees against the crop. So that's then the... I can also play around and I want to get it inverted, that's fine. Use the layer, again the combo layer, the inside and invert it. Black, white, inverted and color it. So that's the end product. Last year I didn't do it with more sharpen, but that was the end product of the workflow. That's inverted. And now that's the recent one, sometimes in here, the 7th of December with good seeing and also more sharp. And you see the difference. This is a small sunspot right here. So that's, you see that clear cut, okay. That is bad seeing. Yeah, that's the difference. Good seeing, bad seeing. Much better camera, worse camera, difficult to focus, and also more pixel related to the high power. So then I also could do a flat white image with the filter and see the sunspot as well. At this stage, there was a rare opportunity to get sunspots with my telescope. So that's the hydrogen alpha the same day. Here I also see the sunspots, better the prominences, and in color. So, but here there are two ways the prominences I can get. Either a color balance of the normal exposed disk, but it gets them pixelated, or I do the same technique as I showed, combine the overexposed and normal exposed. And then I recently found a new technique to get the prominences more, more with a black background. So that's the overexposed image. You see it's orange. But now, according to Parker, sort of, maybe that's maybe the reality, how it looks like. Mm-hmm. But maybe it looks not so artistic. That's the question. that's a combination with the overexposed prominences. Now I show you a technique with how what you can do with it. So I use the hydrogen alpha level tool, only for that layer, of dominated. Then I use the curves and play around with the curves with the histogram and get then this result. Get rid of the orange and have it only this red environment for the prominences and effect. The challenge is you can also erase the prominences completely, so it's a little bit fine too. So that's before. Yeah, you see the prominence in both ways, but that's so that's the technique I found out. So then I do the same Latin image and okay, and that's the software I use for the SDO images. That's a good application from the solar window. So the solar as a title. Yeah, and that's a good application. So that's the end result of this technique. So about wildlife imaging, that's what can I do with wildlife imaging? You can see sunspots, parkourates, solar eclipses, Iridis, Aurores, and transits of Venus and Mercury. I go through it. That's the wildlife image with a 10-inch telescope of Reno and Collicutt. You see the conformation of the very good, the structure of the sunspots. That's what I could do with my one. It was not too bad at this stage, so that's the difference with my one. 60 millimeter refractors. So that's sometimes when you have a haze of a wildfire, it is like a filter, and you need no filter at all, and you can image the sun like that. But that's only when you have this condition. That was in the US last year after the solar eclipse in August 2017. So that's you can see the biggest transits in wildlife. And you can see also annular eclipses in wildlife and the total solar eclipse. Let's don't go in more detail than we have so then in wildlife sometimes also you can direct get the iridescence of the sun. That's amazing. That's the it's like a, I think it's a refraction of cloud droplets. What makes the colors like a prism that light is split up in different colors. And when the droplets are lined up in the right way, the ice crystals can be hit. You know, it's all in some cases of that solar halo. Okay. So you can image that as well in wildlife or synchron solar. So now, in the old world, that's the ultimate thing. So now, elements of hydrogen alpha. Here the filaments, the sunspots, and here the prominences as well. So that's what you see in hydrogen alpha, and that's what we look at. So that is more in detail what I mentioned before. You can see also the sparkles. So that was my first images from the Venus transit in hydrogen alpha when I put the camera on the ocular. So that was the best I could get. But impressively, I got the prominence is quite good. At this time, I had not the skills to do that imaging what I do now. But that was a good thing. So, and I processed input. So that's as an annular eclipse, I could also do with hydrogen alpha. And that's the what I do now. The image, and that was the biggest prominence I got in January 16th. That was the best I got. Then you can also fill the color black. The disks are the disk black. You have only the prominence of the ring. You can do that as well. Another way to see the prominence is or you use a bigger solar telescope, get more details. Or you can look, use a barrel, get a more, but you need. I could see in for the power amount of the use. So here that's the inverted, so I can invert it as well. So that's for example a good example of the overexposed prominence combined with hydrogen alpha. That's maybe it looks like that now after that solar particle. That's solar minimum, typically solar minimum sun with a very tiny sunspot. I don't see it where it is. So it's here. Problem. In Hudson Key, you see it better. In here, there's filament, you know, the big filament, it was several years ago. And then another filament goes directly to the prominence.
Mm.
And 15, and then inverted, it looks like it's a leaf. It's a leaf. Yeah. So, yeah, now we're coming to the sunspots.
Oh, come on.
That was in the US. So, that was at the solar maximum on October 14th. Do you think it's a smiley face? The sun is smiling, or?
It's pissed off.
Yeah.
So, this is a Palo. That was one of the few occasions I could get a good Palo. This is sunspot morning. That's classic in Penumbra. Look at the plains around it. Yes. In the magnetic sphere, the magnetic sphere, how they swirl it. So that's the classic flare. X1 flare in 2014 here. It's one of the best. And nice prominence as well. This is the old technique where I colored it so long till I get this then more prominent and get the prominence. So that's inverted. It's also interesting. Like the fishing show. Hi, John.
Hi, Aaron.
Yeah. So, and now also come to the main topic. So, photograph is when it transits across the sun like the plane. That was a market shop. That was with small sharpen, and that was without more sharpen. That is one of my favorite images in the meantime. And that's made in the yearbook as well.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the calcium K. As I said, you see more the sunspots. And the plane is very well, and also the grays. And the magnetic energy comes out much more. And you get the bright chromospheric network. The kids are very excited when they look through the telescope and see it. I'm as old man as I say. I don't know if you can see it, John, but yeah. So that's the structures of the calcium K, the grains, the prominences, the supercannulation, the pores, the sunspots there. And then, yes, there are so-called microfluid layers there. So-called element forms. But that's what we see. Okay. No filaments. You can guess them, maybe, but it's not. And that's the comparison hydrogen and hydrogen, the same. So that's the difference. So now that's what I could see with my camera. Yes, that was the big size of the solar maximum. That more overexposed it. And that was partial eclipse. Last year, in August 17th. And here I did some trick because at this time I didn't know how to process prominence in calcium K. So when I reprocessed it, I said, okay, I use hydrogen alpha cross prominences there, so it's a hybrid. So that looks cool, so it's the hydrogen alpha prominences in calcium K. So that's the best prominence that I got with calcium K during this. After this one, so that's how to get on the test. And that's the difference. I invert only the disk, not the prominence anymore. This looks more aesthetic. So that's now the current situation. What we have the minimum sunspot and calcium K, you see them like more in the little prominence. So that's the consumption in a sunspots at all. So now we're coming to the next 15 minutes, to the main topic, or the extra topic about ISS consists across the sun and the moon. That's quite exciting, it needs careful planning, it's a lot of adrenaline, it's like an eclipse, it's only a certain place, you need to plan and prepare. It's only more frequent than the eclipses, so you have plenty of software can exactly know where it is. So then you have luck with the clouds. So some facts about the ISS. It's now, I think 20 years is here. 20 years, and it's voted from at least 104 nations. It's 4 football places large, the ISS. And yes, it's an icon, it's the third brightest object in the sky. Mm-hmm. After Moon, Venus, it's then the ISS, the third brightest one. And that is an example I did after the dinner of the astrophotography competition. Very distant, the ISS. It's not always the same distance because it depends on the angle where you're standing in the ISS. Normally it's 40 kilometers, but it varies. So that ice was distant about 1,800 kilometers, so it's very tiny. So that's a little bit better. So that's, you see, the tiny ISS. Four frames. I was too late with the driving. I underestimated the driving time from the Novotel LRC to Marikai, so it was just 5 minutes before, so I could only set up the tripod and the camera and then this adventure. And then I processed it, it contrasted much higher, made the moon a little bit brighter to see the dark eyes. That's 1, 2, 3. It's sometimes difficult. I didn't find it at first. I thought that I didn't achieve anything. I thought, okay, I didn't find it. It took me about a long time to find that out. That it's the ISS. That's sort of moving with the car. So that's with the camera. I can do that. That's a bit brightened. So. And here there was another one with the moon. There was a little bit of better distance, about 600 kilometers from my home. And the exposure spouse 1/200 seconds. Ideal should be the exposures very short exposures because the ice is quite big. So about 1,200 is desired. That's what's processed in all. So now I come to the ice transit of the sun. The preparation and planning, the exact time and location. You need the atomic clock. Then you need a useful this prediction software, weather forecast. That's a challenge because most weather forecasts are not right here. Also, when you have sun and manga rays, and it's raining. So the meteors are possibly the best ones. Then arrive at the location 30 minutes before to set it up, to see where the location is, where the sun is, and how it works. And then you hope for clouds not passing through the transit. And the distance is also decisive in planning. In the same principle, yes, that you can predict other transits of birds or aeroplanes can't predict, become very long happen. And it's ideal to rehearse, as I said. And it start imaging about 5 to 10 seconds before the transit. So that's the workflow about the application, what I have, the weather application. And then I have the atomic clock that unlocked it. That's very important. Only the challenge is sometimes in location you don't have mobile data. Then you need to use the systemic clock and must add or subtract before that before. So in the planning you must look if you have mobile data. That's my favorite transit software. The prediction in Android. We have the similar also for Apple as well, I think, and for the PC. And then, so you save it for the location. You can also input the location you like. That was for a moon transit. Yes, it was the cloud, so I couldn't do it. It's only to show. So that's, it shows up the transits coming for the next 10 days. For example, it's the lunar sunlit one I've never done. Yeah, didn't succeed. So then you have Google there, Google Maps, and you see where you are. There's GPS, so you can open it, you know where you are exactly. That's cool. So then you have also details. I thought only just the details, you can then work out what the time is, how long the transit goes, when it goes exactly, and so you can plan it as well. Is that cool? And also the distance to it as well. So there's a another one that's very good in PC, Android, and Apple, the Transit Finder. That's the same, but it's more flexible to put in the location on various places. So that makes it a little bit easier. And you have also the distance very quick there. And you can predict, for example, 4 stars, that's good. That's close, 400 kilometers. Whereas 1 star is not so good. So that's the CalScan is a gold standard still. That's also useful. But now the change comes in with the design of the maps. I think you can't print it out so well anymore. It's more complicated. But it's a still useful tool at home, and it says you what's going on. So that's, you can get it to the exact location and map what happens. And you should go close to the center. So that's an example in near Palpable in Iceland. I've had luck to do the ISIS transit in Hudson Cay. That was the setup at the farm, the car, so that you can really read the computer. So that is the shadow for it. And that's the atomic clock, the setup. And here, that was the farmer, he was the very friendly. At first, he asked me what I do in here, say, what should I say? Oh, did you see it? But no, I just prepared it. And then he passed by and I said, oh, that was nice. So you can also get to know other areas, it's fun. So that was it afterwards. With a couple of days, I was quite excited and quite happy. So that's the last part of the presentation, how to image the transit, what to do. Here it's important when you stack the image, the video, you do it with planet. Because the planet keeps the sound in the right position in the middle, and then you can copy and paste the ISS from the video frames in the right position. That's good. So that's, yeah. And that's the technique I do. There may be other techniques. Somebody says to me, you can do it with people, but that's the technique I use. There may be many ways leading to home. Say that I select each ISS frame with the magnetic lasso, then process it, sharpen it, and also look, reduce the voice, then copy the text, and adjust it, then also with the spectrum. Then I do this own place, and then afterwards I get the image, and then I make the usual process of how I do it, to put the comments in. Copy the disk and the comments. Now I show the workflow how I do it. At first, I process the, it's the same as with the moon, so that's the same. So if you have the moon, that's the same. You have a single frame, video frame, here you can have a slider and then you can get the frames. The frames that we export the current, export it, and then I have it there. And now when I have this frame saved, I open it in Photoshop, zoom it in, use the selection with the magnetic lasso, but also the polygon tool is okay as well. Select it, then I process it, right contrast, then the more sharpened tool, the noise also get a little better. Still pixelated because I think the exposure time was not optimal, but that's good enough. So, and then I do with all 17 frames, so I get them with the function. And here, I didn't like that it's so a little bit on the edge. It's not the same, so I said, okay, I use the because point tool, that layer, and skew it a little bit. So then, color it, I do the same process, coloring it, contrasting the text in the final image. It was just when I had the transit. Just 1 minute before a cloud was crossing the sun. And then I had the high clouds here. You see the pixelation, I think it's not so good. What I decided then, there was half an hour, 20 minutes before a fantastic image. So I copied and pasted the ISS in both. So I did it. So I decided to do that. And you see then, of course, a little bit of rotation. Yeah. So maybe somehow 3 years ago, this transitor crisis here, that was a far away, but also the bird was flying. And the birds, I think the same technique as with the ISS, it's the same. It's the same. And also not recent, there were three birds crossing within 4 seconds. So, and then, what they said, I was imaging it in some lane, I found an auto stick, there's something there, there should not be there, that's not the sunspot. And there's, it moved.
And you crashed.
Pardon?
And you crashed.
Satellite, yes. Okay, it's in something. Other says it could be a bird. So that was the, that was really a surprise. And then I heard another voice. That was inverted. And then I have another surprise, some transit for you, it was soon at the end of the presentation.
We found Santa.
So a basic calcium scope with filters, what kind of budget are you talking about for a basic scope? What kind of, roughly?
Basic scope, of the price you mean?
Yeah.
The whole equipment that was in 2012, the calcium cavity is about 900 pounds.
Right. So you buy the filters and fit them onto a standard scope for the calcium?
You can put them in any effect.
Okay. But I notice you're using sort of lump refractor, is that because they're very high quality refractors, the lump ones, so they're suitable for the benefit of the solar region?
It's the same size as the Ocoros. You can exchange it. I use the lump telescope also, it's wide length.
Yeah.
It's a normal telescope as well.
But the lump telescopes are very good?
Yeah. Got the lump, interesting, they don't do that kind of telescope anymore. They
right.
only sell the calcium cavity. But my one was the last one.
Okay.
Anyway,
it was only $900 for the calcium setup.
Pardon?
So it was about $900 for the calcium setup.
Yeah. 900.
That's pretty good. Thank you.
But
I thought it'd be more than that.
So, but it's relatively affordable, and it's working. Yeah.
I've got a Newtonian and I got one of those spider films that looks like aluminium foil. Is there a filter that you can stick onto your camera?
The camera you can...
It filters 99% of the light, you can see white light.
When you put it on the camera, it can do it as well. I have shown this, that you can also order some rainbow when it's the right side, you put it in the camera. I have an image here.
I've got a tinfoil across of the in front of the telescope aperture.
It's okay, yeah.
But is there a filter that makes me, or that enables the camera to see all the grain and filaments and all that stuff? Like, is there an H-alpha filter that you can put right in front of your sensor? You know, like those flippant filters that you
use
for. I think that they started to have something, but that's quite expensive. There needs to be an interim is a little bit front and back filter there.
Oh.
I think there is something from Daystar, so far I know there is something there for the camera, but it's possibly it's expensive. So far I know there is something there.
It's one of the aperture, but it's like tin foil. about it.
No, but you wouldn't want to.
And it works out nice and periodic nice. You could
use that
window
margin
now for
the
But
the key you can use for white light, for seeing sunspots, you can put the key for height of the camera.
So the H alpha is already filtered out by the time it comes through the film foil.
Yeah.
It's a different, the in foil, it's a different way to get the white light. There's a different filter. It filters about 500 data, but then the light is about 600. That's, yes, so that's different. The white light filter only filters that white light what you get from the photosphere.
Yeah.
And you see the sunspot in faculty. That's it.
Yeah, the white light filter is pretty low today.
And with the foil from Bada, for example, sunspot you can see well. As in for the solar maximum, you can do it, but it must tighten it really with the camera. That must, and the filter must be good.
Yeah.
So, but there is special equipment so far now from data where I can put hydrogen out on the camera, but it's.
Kind of a special lens, isn't
yeah,
it? Because there's so many elements needed to make it work that it's one of those things that they're not very popular, I think, because they're very expensive and it's almost not worth the quality. Might as well just go sell the telescope.
So you have
that
to put a white light filter in the front and put a flip-in hydrogen alpha filter on the camera.
No, the white light filter would knock down almost everything.
Oh.
Otherwise, you'd crook your camera. So.
You have to use specific filters for a specific wavelength and then you get the specific results.
Yeah.
And there's three popular is white light, calcium K and hydrogen alpha, but now the sodium line or magnesium coming up. Maybe
when's the minimum coming up?
The minimum is coming up, don't make a good slide because this is interesting, coming up next year in 2020. I know you were not there, but there are two prediction studies. There are two prediction studies. The one study says the maximum is at 25. That's the conventional one, and the new one says in 24. It's an Indian study from the Center of Space Excellence that predicts the next cycle will be the same or bigger. The climate change is not good. And the minimum is starts 1920,
21 and 22. Well, thank you, Otto. Really, really good. Lots of detail. I didn't know a lot of that stuff. So that's really cool. Thanks, guys. It's actually a quite large hydrogen alpha solar telescope. In this oven, which is, but the current status is all rather dismantled, etc. But it will be back, and that's a very, very good solar telescope, which maybe this coming year, things are back up and running, might be able to actually think about this a bit.
Then to have a new camera on that lens.
Oh, right, cool. Okay.
So
that
hasn't been chosen yet, but it won't be the old one with the fire wire.
Well, we used it. We did actually do. We saw the Venus transit picture of it.
It did work. Yes.
We did a. We used the telescope here for the Venus transit at the same time, 2012. And we did a live show where we were webcasting the Venus transit, and we also did a lot of stuff with one of the partial solar books as well. And that went really well. So it's a really good telescope.
When we're doing the cabling, as we reassemble the telescope. We'll be cabling for that new camera.
Awesome.
So when it arrives,
so we may have said
we
can
plug it in and we'll be able to
some
get the images down into the public area. And
yeah. So we may have said that we can possibly arrange to do some.
Absolutely.
Which would be absolutely great.
Yes.
So we can do a solar imaging project for the group at some point once it's all up and running.
Yep.
Which would be really nice to use that equipment because it's not really been utilised to, since it was put in, it's been underutilised, I think, compared to that.
So it's also purchased a similar Solon X3 telescope.
A new one?
Yeah.
So now they bought a little one from somebody many years ago back in 2012 called little
no, this, this is a brand new one.
Oh, right, okay.
It's the latest.
So that's the Solon X4.
It's
the
successor of the Solon X62 what I have.
All right.
Now they made a Solon X3. get much more works of fucking.
So the society has that now, or
yes, it's been used for outreach
yeah.
so far, but it can be used for
mission. Yeah, so we sort of have some solar telescopes available there. Anyone's interested in maybe trying to get something going and having a go at some images, we do have some equipment available that could be used. Definitely, we could arrange, no doubt, we could arrange to have it here available or somewhere available set up for some images. So if anyone's keen to give it a go, cameras are no problem. We have cameras. any USB camera will do, for sure.
It is so, no one's going to look dedicated with the full disk.
Yeah, it depends on the size of the camera.
The camera, so
yeah.
I think the head camera that I use is also the same. Yes,
yeah.
Otherwise, you'll get only parts of some
Yeah. So we need to figure out if somebody will have a camera we can scavenge or borrow or whatever that's got a good appropriate size lens for sure. There's a few ones that quite a few people have got SA-174s floating around. I know that they use for planetary and various other uses, so I've no doubt we could get our hands on that suitable camera from somebody for a session if anyone's keen at some point in the next months. Back in the beginning of the year.
If you want, if there's any upkeep event or something, then know it in advance. It simply said something about the botanic garden.
Yeah, there's a whole big thing going on there which they don't know all about.
But maybe it's only from the
botanic. Yeah, okay, cool. Well, maybe.
I only need to know it in advance.
Okay, so as I said before, January's an off month. That's the last society, so there won't be a meeting in January. I'll be looking to get something good going in February. But also, we're going to have a Astrophotography Group Challenge, which Jonathan's generous to make the prize for, which is a signed copy of a image in the Southern Sky book, which, while not totally the newest thing out there, so some of the references, cameras and things in it are a little out of date. The actual book is a wonderful book that shows you all the things in the sky that are good to image from the southern hemisphere, which is really quite unique. I've used it quite extensively to find objects that I would never have otherwise thought of imaging.
What is it called?
Imaging the Southern Sky.
Imaging the Southern Sky. It's by two guys.
Stephen Chadwick and Andrew.
Thank you. We've got a sign up with that, which we're going to use as a prize for some kind of group challenge, which again, I'm looking for suggestions on what would be a good group challenge. We need something that people with different kinds of equipment can all in some way take part in the same challenge. So an area of the sky or something that's available through the summer, through the later part of summer, that you can do with a small telescope, big telescope, whatever, that we can find something. So we need to find a challenge subject that we can use, that everyone can go at, and that's viable for everybody. So no one chooses, that's great for me with my high modifications from Castle Gray, but if you've got a Newtonian in this useless and something, it's going to be more balanced. A nice comet would have been great, but we've come to a little after that. So maybe there'll be another fine comet coming up or something. You never know. Anyway, so that's great. Thanks all for coming, and thanks this year for really great attendances at these meetings. It's been really nice that you showed up. Mainly I'm looking for feedback on the Facebook group about what kind of subjects everyone's keen on doing, and if anyone's got expertise they would like to offer and maybe do a talk or something, please do come forward, because no point me standing up here yapping. Alright, thanks very much everybody, and thanks for the year, and if anyone wants to pick up Gavin's film partway through, it'd be delighted to have it there, I'm sure.
Do we want to listen to that?
No, some sci-fi.